Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to see you here tonight for what promises to be a very, very interesting lecture, and later on at the CVAR, a very interesting exhibition where we will see perhaps the oldest illustrations of this island. Just a few words about the speaker before we start. Annie Castello studied medieval history, PhD, and she's an academic librarian working at the Baden State Library in Karlsruhe, where she's heading the Special Collections and Manuscripts Department. Thus, we have the manuscript, the Grunberg manuscript now with us this evening. She's very interested in Genoa and the Genoese, and she has read about the Genoese in Cyprus. So yesterday we were chasing the Genoese all over Cyprus, whatever was left, whatever is left here. She was astonished with the medieval monuments that we have here in Cyprus. I don't think this is going to be her one and only visit. I think we will have Annika again with us very shortly. Before I pass on the floor to the ambassador of Germany, may I please take this opportunity to say thank you to the German embassy for sponsoring the lecture and the exhibition. Thank you to the staff of the German Embassy, and especially Macrina, who has worked closely with us. Thank you to the staff of CVAR, which I've been pestering for the last 2 weeks, and especially Haralambos Paschalidis, whom I kept up till midnight sometimes trying to organize and design the exhibition. And of course, a big thank you to our speaker, Annie Castello, who immediately responded to our request and came to Cyprus for this lecture. Mrs. Ambassador, would you like to say a few words? Thank you all for being here tonight.
Good evening, everybody. Dear Rita, dear Annie Castello, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. First of all, let me thank you, Rita, for hosting the opening of this exhibition on some of the earliest and rarest illustrations of Cyprus here at the Center for Visual Arts, CIVA. And thank you, Dr. Annika Stello, for cooperating in this special project. We are looking forward to your lecture tonight, and for coming especially to Cyprus on this occasion. You arrived here on a Saturday and you're going to stay for one week. Let me say a few words about this exhibition and the participation of the German Embassy in this project. Actually, Rita was one of the first contacts when I arrived in Cyprus at the beginning of August. And the idea for this exhibition had come up during a brainstorming meeting that Rita had with colleagues from the embassy, I believe, a year ago, where she shared her knowledge about the German 15th century traveler Konrad Grünenberg and his visit to Cyprus in 1486. My colleagues in the embassy thereupon contacted the Baden State Library, where the original manuscript of this journey is kept. And we were very lucky, as our email reached directly Dr. Annika Stello, who was immediately interested in cooperating with us on this project. What we can see here today, later on in the exhibition, are illustrations of the different cities that Grünenberg visited in Cyprus, together with his notes on this experience. Grünenberg was a patrician in Konstanz, in the south of Germany, and son of the mayor of Konstanz. The travel book of Konrad Grünenberg, with perhaps the earliest illustrations of Cyprus, is a very interesting journal and a prominent example of early travels to Cyprus and of a period where travel literature was very popular. Already in the Middle Ages, people traveled to Cyprus by ship. Its strategic position not only made Cyprus an attraction to conquerors, but it was also the reason for intercultural contacts, flourishing trade, and interesting visits, which rendered Cyprus a multicultural island. And of course, pilgrims on their way to the Holy Land came to Cyprus and arrived in Limassol or Paphos on their way to the Holy Land. In the travel literature of the time, travelers praised the land and its people. They wrote that the land was fruitful of corn, silk, oil, sugar, and wine, mentioned the beautiful hills, most pleasant and delightful valleys, warm suns, green grasses, and shady groves. Living here for now almost 3 months, I can already confirm that all these descriptions of the medieval time still hold true for today. Let me quote from the manuscript of Grünenberg. The goddess Venus lived on the island with other goddesses, and Bacchus' gifts appeared there in abundance too, because the grapes are big and sweet like honey and give such good wine that nobody can drink it without mixing it with water. Ladies and gentlemen, later when we will have a glass of wine, we will not mix our glass with water, before listening to the lecture and being hosted at Sivar for a glass of wine, let me once again thank warmly Rita Severis from Sivar and Dr. Annika Stello for the work and dedication that they put into this exhibition in order to make the story of Konrad Grünenberg and of the travelers of 15th century known to us. And as Rita already did, I would like to thank especially my colleague Macrina Amanatido at the German Embassy for her work, for her optimism, her perseverance, and creative ideas that she has put into this project, which is an example of the fruitful cooperation between Cyprus and Germany. May I now invite Annika Stello for the lecture, and thank you very much.
Well, good evening from me too. Dear Ambassador Schlimm, dear Rita, thank you above all for the invitation. I'm really glad to be here today. And everything has been said, Macrina, for your coordination and for being there every time something went wrong. I'm really, really grateful to be here today and to have already seen the exhibition and to see how it came along. Really, it is a great pleasure to be here today and to reactivate part of my PhD thesis. The subject I wrote about some 15 years ago was centered around the later medieval Eastern Mediterranean, so the region we are in, but more focused on the Black Sea area, which is part of the Eastern Mediterranean, if you talk trade and if you talk relations between people. This subject I wrote about 15 years ago has very little to do with my everyday work now, which is focused mostly on regional, more monastic history, dynastic history of southwestern Germany. So I kind of jumped at the occasion to come back to my old longtime project with this lecture today. And I'm very grateful for that too, because it's fun to come back from time to time to old times. So when I received an email in April this year from the German embassy asking if we, that is the Baden State Library where I work now, would be willing to cooperate on an exhibition project here in Nicosia, centered around one of our best known manuscripts, which is the Grünenberg Travelogue we are talking about. You see one of the images here. We were curious, but not immediately enthusiastic, because the time frame was really short, and it wasn't clear from the beginning where this project should lead. So we were kind of hesitating, but then we had our first video call with Rita and Macrina, and everything kind of fell just into place. And it continued to do so. So this was really one of the smoothest projects I've ever done. And thank you for that, Rita especially, and Macrina. Well, as you know, this lecture takes place in the context of an exhibition on Konrad Grünenberg at the CVAR. Konrad Grünenberg, as the ambassador already said, was a citizen of Constance in southern Germany and undertook the pilgrimage to the Holy Land in 1486. His journey took him from his hometown on the Lake of Constance across the Alps to Venice, and then by ship along the eastern Adriatic coast, so Croatia, around Greece and via Crete and Rhodes and Cyprus to Jaffa in Palestine, which was the customary route at his time. Thus, he became part of the very busy sea traffic between Western Europe and the Eastern Mediterranean, where, among others, the Italian maritime republics of Genoa and Venice played a major role throughout the later Middle Ages. Grünenberg traveled by ship wherever possible, because that was the fastest way to reach the Holy Land at the time. Nevertheless, his journey took him the better part of a year until his return home. So he started somewhere around Easter and came back to Constance in like October or November or something. He left us a colorful account of his adventures, and we know this account mainly from two manuscripts, which were both probably handwritten by Grünenberg himself, which is rare for the Middle Ages. Usually medieval manuscripts are not written by the author of the text, but are copies of a later date. In case of Grünenberg, we have two what we call autographs, so manuscripts by his own hand, and this is really something special. The older one of the two is probably the Karlsruhe one, which is part of the collection I'm the curator of. And it just looks like this. Grünenberg, as I said, was far from being an exception in his traveling activities. Ever since antiquity and even before, the Mediterranean Sea was a space people regularly traveled or navigated from every shore and in nearly every direction. They had many reasons to do so, everything between warfare, from the Punic Wars against Rome to the Arab conquest of the Iberian Peninsula, or the Crusades in what we call the Middle East today. So everything from warfare to leisure, leisure seen as exploration for curiosity's sake, what we call tourism today. Grünenberg seems to fall in this last category. If we look at the focus of his travelogue, he was a pilgrim, but if you read his account of his journey, it seems more like he was curious to see everything he didn't know. The most constant impulse, though, for people from around the Mediterranean basin to board a ship and set sail was trade, always and every time. Throughout the Middle Ages, and in spite of changing political conditions, trade across the Mediterranean never stopped and was certainly an important and constant field of cultural contact and exchange. Now in the 15th century, the rift between Western Europe and the Near Eastern regions is firmly established. What the Roman Empire had once united under common rule and what then began to drift apart in late antiquity and Byzantine times with the division in Latin and Greek world, got irrevocably separated in the 15th century. The Crusader states were history at the time, and the last vestiges of the Byzantine Empire disintegrate while the Ottoman Empire is on the rise and expanding, and thus the balance of powers is shifting significantly. The conditions under which travel and trade can take place under these circumstances change too. But commercial navigation continues in spite of everything, even for the merchants from Latin Europe, who are those for whom the changing conditions became the most difficult to navigate. For them, the final loss of the eastern lands to Muslim reign meant substantial new obstacles in trade that had, and this was a trade that had been very active since the so-called Venetian Crusade in 1204, where the Venetians firmly established themselves in Constantinople, and which was a very important date for Western trade in the Eastern Mediterranean. So who exactly traveled the Mediterranean in the 15th century and why? What led people to risk the often dangerous ship routes, because they were dangerous? And how did one travel by ship in the 15th century? What routes did they employ and why? What were the conditions on board? And what goods did they transport? Last but not least, how do we know about all this? I'll try to give you a general idea on these topics tonight by concentrating on the Eastern Mediterranean region, but not specifically on Cyprus, and by picking up certain aspects who may serve as an example for the larger picture. And I would like to begin at the end, so to speak, namely with the last question, how do we know all this? Meaning, what are the sources? As this is always the main point for any historian. So I can't spare you that. Fortunately, we have numerous sources giving us more or less detailed information on navigation, on trade, and on other related topics for the time. Arguably, the most entertaining among them are travelogues, like Grünenberg's, which was the starting point for our event today. There are many examples for this kind of narrative sources since the beginning of the Crusades. Crusaders, diplomats, merchants, spies, all of them left us texts describing their experiences abroad. Some accounts are longer, some shorter, some concentrate on politics, some on geographical or architectural features, some on the personal experience, some on practical advice for other travelers. There are regular handbooks for merchants and for travelers alike. One of the most famous among them is certainly Marco Polo's account of his journey from Italy to China and back, written in around 1300. In the 15th century, though, it seems to come into fashion to write down a report of some kind when returning from a longer journey. We have over 150 travel accounts from German travelers for the 14th and 15th century alone. And another around 50 from French travelers, around 40 from Dutch travelers. So you see, we have like 300, 400 accounts from Northern Europe alone. While the texts that were meant as handbooks or guides for merchants or pilgrims mostly focus on practical matters, like how to book a passage, or how to convert foreign currency, the same things you find in travel guides today, or how to convert measures, which is important for traders, of course, or where to buy certain necessities. Most of these narrative sources are highly subjective by nature. They give the personal views and opinions of the author, who most often does not feel a need to be particularly precise. Embellishing is part of the genre, if you don't write a handbook, that is. For example, Grünenberg tells us, while describing his stay on Rhodes, that he saw a rat as big as a fox on a ship from Naples, and a big sheep with a tail as large as another sheep. Well, in contrast to that, we have countless archival sources, like shipping lists, contracts of all sorts, bookkeeping records of both private persons and public administration. We have notarial deeds and lots of other seemingly boring material, which can be very interesting if you look closer. Despite their rather dry character, these often give us quite detailed ideas about the merchandise, its volume, its costs and value, and even about taxes to be paid for certain goods in certain ports, which makes it possible to calculate the volume of certain goods. So, for example, if you take slave trade, always good topic, slave trade, there are really differing opinions about the volume of slave trade in the 15th century. Everyone has agreed that there was slave trade, but some say there were only a few, like a byproduct of other shipping enterprises. And some say there were large quantities of slaves shipped around the Mediterranean in the 15th century. If you have tax records of certain ports of call, you can calculate the number of slaves coming through, which gives a much better idea about the real volume of a good like slaves. Let me show you an example. This is an excerpt from the Massaria records in Kaffa. The Massaria is the Genoese administration in the Genoese city of Kaffa on the Crimea, today's Feodosia. Crimea, we all know that. So the Genoese were very active in the Black Sea, as were the Venetians, and their main hub was Kaffa. They had a whole administration there, and the administration kept records, which they had to send back to Genoa every year to be audited. And it looks like this. You have a two-column bookkeeping. On the left, you have the dues, and on the right, you have the income. Can we have the enlargement so you can see what I mean? I hope you can read it a little bit. If you look, well, it's hard to read, I know. I'll help you. You have a date here, which is 1425, 15th July. Well, that's not so important. What I wanted to show you is this. This reads in Latin, Nicolinus de Grimaldis, patronus sui navis, so Nicolino Grimaldi, we all know the name Grimaldi, patron of his own ship, armatus, which means armed, an armed ship, and it's a ship he's arming for the commune of Genoa. So he gets no, he doesn't get protection. He's kind of I'm sorry, I've lost my speech. So you get the gist. The commune of Genoa commands him to arm a ship. And this is what he's paying for here. So we know how much it costs to arm a ship to go somewhere, which is interesting in itself. And we know that there was one Niccolo Grimaldi active in the Black Sea trade at the time and in contact with the commune in Genoa, so in mainland Italy, with probably tight connections to the mainland, which is quite a far distance away. So these are archival sources. Now, what can all these sources tell us about traveling in the late Middle Ages? First, that there are several different types of ships, adapted to their respective purposes, which is not really surprising. I don't want to bore you with technical details, so I'll just say that we find ships of many forms, functions, and size, as adapted to the purpose. So heavier ships and bigger ships for large cargo loads, smaller, faster ships for transport of, let's say, envoys who needed to be somewhere fast. Ships with oars or without oars or with more oars. Can we have the next image, please? Thank you. So this is what one type of ship looks like in the 15th century. It's really rather typical. We have oars and we have sails, which is practical. If you don't have wind, you can still move. You have a kind of house or baldachin on the hind side of the ship. And usually, if there were passengers, they were under deck. Can we have the next one? Yes. This is the same type of ship, but in a freer interpretation. It looks more on the move as the other. But it's in fact the same. You have the baldachin here, you have the sails and the oars, and it's probably even from the same shipbuilder, because they date from the same time, from the same city, and from the same context. As a side note, the second half of the 15th century also sees fundamental technical advances in shipbuilding, which made the ships more durable and enabled them to navigate under more demanding conditions. This was the precondition for the great explorations in the late 15th and early 16th centuries for navigation around the west coast of Africa to India, across the Atlantic, and from the Atlantic around South America and the Pacific. We all know the names associated with these achievements, like Vasco da Gama or Columbus, Magellan. But let us stay in the Mediterranean. The ships used in the 15th century were generally not suited for longer trips over open water, or rather, they were not suitable for higher seas. Therefore, the routes mostly followed the coastlines, where the ships could stay relatively close to the shore and find shelter quickly should the need arise, for example, if the weather turned suddenly. One did not cross over open water if one could avoid it. At the time, ships usually also arranged to stay in port for the night. Staying on open water during the night was dangerous considering the technical and navigational limitations of this ships. Therefore, the main ship routes at the time lay between the east coast of Spain, the Balearic Islands, southern France, and western Italy, and then on to the east. I've brought you a Portoland chart of the 15th century, just so you know with what kind of map the seafarers at the time worked. This is a Portoland chart because there's nothing marked except the ports. So I don't know if you recognize it, but this is the Mediterranean. Cyprus is here. The Black Sea is here. Italy is here. And you see, nothing is marked except the shores, but the shores are marked in great detail. What you need when you're on a ship. You don't need the inland, you need the ports. And so the main routes went around the Balearic. We have the Iberian Peninsula with the big mountain of Gibraltar here, the green one. The Spanish coast, the Balearic Islands, Corsica, Sicily, the Greek islands, Cyprus, and the Levant coast. The main routes lay between the east coast of Spain and southern France, so in this area here, which was relatively safe. And then via Sicily around the tip of Italy here, and over to the Adriatic coast. And then along the coast here, across the Isles to the east. Those traveling to the Near East or Egypt would go onwards from Greece, where the routes split, towards Crete, Rhodes, and Cyprus. So they made their way like here, over here, and then along the coast down to Egypt. Those on the way to Constantinople or further on to the Black Sea ports would continue across the Aegean to Chios or Lesbos and Gallipoli, which is here. We can see it, it's too small. And from there, they could go on through the Bosporus northwards along the coast to the Danube estuary, which is here, and the Crimea, or south along the northern Anatolian coast towards Trebizond, which is here somewhere. In addition to these long west-eastern routes, there was also travel from north to south and vice versa, roughly in the area between Alexandria in the south and Constantinople in the north, all through the Greek islands and around the coast of Asia Minor. Of course, there were also north-south routes in the western Mediterranean between North Africa and the Iberian Peninsula and Majorca, or between Tunisia, Sicily, and mainland Italy, for example. But let us stay in the eastern area. Longer sea journeys always had to be planned carefully, even in the relatively calm inland sea that is the Mediterranean, at least compared to the Atlantic Ocean. The French, Catalan, or Genoese ships, for example, had to stop sea traffic towards the eastern Mediterranean roughly between November and February because the Strait of Messina, that is the passage here between Sicily and mainland Italy, was not passable in the winter months. And likewise, they could not set out from Italy or Spain towards the eastern shores before February or March at the earliest. And in reverse, Western European merchants or other travelers had to time their departure from the Levant ports, from the eastern ports, very carefully if they wished to return home in the same year and not get stuck on the way. Considering that the transfer from Venice to Jaffa in Palestine took travelers like Grünenberg at least 2 to 3 months, and only if nothing unexpected happened, there was not much time left to stay somewhere on the way or in the east before having to start the return journey, unless you wanted to pass the winter abroad, which most people didn't want to do. Most preferred to return home before the end of the year, which put considerable time constraints on any dealings they wished to accomplish during their travels. If they were unlucky and the weather changed too quickly, they had to pass the winter in some port city wherever they happened to be stuck. Besides the fact that this prolonged their absence from home, it also cost money. They had to pay for board and lodging, and some trading goods might perish too, thus jeopardizing a whole year's income. No wonder that those people who traveled regularly started to establish trade posts and downright colonies all along their main routes, if they had the means to do so. For the 15th century, the best known stakeholders of this kind were the republics of Genoa and Venice, who lived off long-distance trading and thus had skilled seamen and were in constant competition with each other. In the early 15th century, their network of trade posts, both the Genoese and the Venetian network of trade posts and territories, covered the northern and eastern shores of the Mediterranean, the Marmara and the Black Seas, and all up to the city of Tana, which is today's Azov, on the Don estuary, which is here. So if you can imagine a little the distance it takes if you start in Genoa here or in Venice on the other side, and you go up to the Don estuary in the Sea of Azov, it's really far. But it was worth it because up there there was a northern branch of the Silk Road which finished there. So it was good trading up there, and it was worth the effort. Other people did the same, if to a lesser extent. Genoa and Venice were the leaders of trade in these regions, but others did the same, of course. This was a necessary measure to enable travel for whichever purpose you wanted to travel across the Mediterranean, and to make a high-risk enterprise a little safer, because a sea journey was always a high-risk thing. No wonder also that the marine insurance was invented at that time in Italy. And the earliest known risk insurance contract we know dates from Genoa in 1347. So there you are. This leads us to the question, who exactly traveled these routes and for what reasons? Well, one of the first reasons that come to my mind every time I think about it is a religious reason. The pilgrimage to Jerusalem and the Holy Land started as early as late antiquity. We know that the Roman Empress Helena visited Palestine, stopping in Cyprus on her way, and she did so explicitly because of her Christian faith and supposedly found the Holy Cross on this occasion, but well, that's legend. Then and ever since, Christians wanted to see the places where Jesus and the Israelites had dwelt. Therefore, pilgrims were constant among travelers in the medieval Mediterranean. Even the largest wars of the time, the Crusades, find their place in this context. When the Fatimid Caliph in Cairo ordered the destruction of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, in 1009, he gave the Latin West the ideal excuse for war against the expanding Muslim sphere of influence. And so the main impetus for the Crusades, starting a few decades later, became the liberation of the sacred places in the Holy Land, which is in fact a combination of pilgrimage and war. Aspects of political and economic power playing into these wars, notwithstanding, the Crusades always kept being a kind of religious journey. In short, a pilgrimage of sorts, at least for some of the participants. And parts of the Western armies traveled by ship. When the Muslim reign over Jerusalem changed and the Mamluk Sultanate in Cairo reallowed the Roman rite in the 14th century, the Franciscan order consequently became the official representation of the Roman Church in Jerusalem. And that was a point where the Western pilgrimage tradition restarted in a more peaceful sense and continued until the Ottoman conquest of the Palestine region in 1517. Most of the travelers at the time, though, had a different reason to brave the sea. The main part of sea traffic revolved around trade and commercial exchange. And while pilgrims, as well as traders, came from a multitude of countries, some were significantly more active than others in the Mediterranean. From a Western perspective, the most influential parties in the 13th to 15th century were probably the merchants from the Italian sea republics. I repeat myself, but it's all I can say about it. So Genoa, Venice, and to a lesser degree, Pisa, also including Ragusa, which is today's Dubrovnik, which was closely linked to Venice. Not only did their merchants have superior navigating skills, but also a high degree of organization. Establishing trade posts in every strategically important corner of the areas they used to sail to regularly, as I already said, assured them a measure of protection against adversity of any kind many other merchants did not have. Nevertheless, the Italians did not have the monopoly on trade, especially not in the Eastern Mediterranean. They had to deal with competition from Arab and Egyptian merchants, from Byzantine or Greek traders, later increasingly from Turkic and Russian colleagues. In fact, as a general observation, those from the countries of the East were mostly involved in north-south trade and rarely ventured towards the West. The Italians, in contrast, and some French and Spanish traders were more interested in the transfer of goods from East to West and vice versa, even if they also did trade between the Black Sea and Egypt, for example. Therefore, certain ports naturally grew into main commercial hubs, the most important one being Pera, that is Constantinople, in the north. Yeah, this is a map where we can see it better. So we have Constantinople here, and Pera was the Italian quarter of Constantinople at the time. So Pera is one of the main hubs. Beirut, Antioch, and several other cities in the east were important places too, as were the islands of Chios, Samos, Rhodes, Cyprus, and especially Crete. To the south, we have Alexandria and Damietta as the main docking points, which are both here somewhere, which only shows this, that this map has a decidedly Western focus, but, well, never mind. So, Alexandria and Damietta, which are old trading towns since antiquity. In which port exactly a certain ship chose to turn over its cargo depended on current political developments and, of course, on the type of cargo they wished to sell or buy. For example, Candia stood under Venetian rule most of the time. Therefore, a Genoese merchant coming from Constantinople and returning to Genoa might have preferred to cross from Genoese Chios, just here, through the Greek Isles directly to the Peloponnese, while a Venetian ship on the same route would have made the detour to Candia, today's Heraklion on Crete, which was the main Venetian city in the east. A ship carrying spices, precious resins, and incense from Arabia would certainly choose a different route than a vessel carrying alum, rose madder, indigo, or slaves from the Black Sea. I won't elaborate on the products traded across the Mediterranean, because there were many. I won't enumerate them. It's boring. I just want to add that trade between East and West was in no way one-sided. As an example, just a few words on textiles. Woven clothes, like wool or linen, for which northern Italy was famous, were always welcome in the East. So the Italians brought clothes to the East. Oriental silk and cotton made their way back. Metallic threads used for embroidery and certain highly expensive textiles were produced in several places around the Mediterranean and traded back and forth. We find imported silver thread from the Oriental regions in Italy, but we also find Italian spun silver in Oriental textiles. So there was an exchange of the same product. And in a way, people like pilgrims or other kinds of non-trading passengers would have been regarded as just another kind of cargo. Periodically, merchants had to deal with additional obstacles. Changing politics sometimes not only limited the possibilities to call at certain ports, they could impact trading options as a whole. In periods where armed conflict broke out in the region, one of the parties involved could lay an embargo on certain goods, which happened regularly. Usually, this did not prevent trade with these goods, though, but it compelled the merchants to take certain precautions or to resort to subterfuge. Let me give you an example. In the 15th century, the conflict between Latin Europe and the Mamluk Sultanate grew more acute. One important characteristic of the Mamluk reign is the role of slaves. The Mamluk army mainly consisted of slaves, and the Sultan was elected from their ranks. As most of those slave soldiers were not allowed to have children, the Mamluks needed a constant supply of slaves to ensure their continued existence or the existence of their army. At the time, they preferred slaves from Central Asia or the Caucasus. So the slave trade from the Caucasus region and Central Asia went mostly by ship and through the Black Sea ports. And here the Italian merchants, both from Genoa and Venice, got involved. Among other slave traders, they often delivered whole shiploads of slaves from the Black Sea to Egypt. When new conflict broke out between Latin Europe and the Mamluks, slaves, which were necessary for the Mamluk armies, became a thing of strategic importance. And several embargoes on slave trade with Egypt were put in place during the late Middle Ages, along with embargoes on other things like wood, which was needed for shipbuilding and so on. But the slave trade was highly profitable. And that's probably why the Italian traders were infamous among their contemporaries for putting their mercantile interests before the Christian cause, so to speak. Genoese, Venetians, and Pisans continued to bring slaves to Egypt in spite of any embargo issued by the Pope or by Western coalitions. They even went so far as to sell fellow Christians taken from Russia and Southeastern Europe, so probably not Roman Catholic Christians, but Christians all the same, and it was forbidden to enslave Christians. They even sold Christians from Southeastern Europe as slaves, or at least they were accused of it. The Italian merchants saw themselves forced to justify their practices on several occasions. As late as 1434, the City Council of Genoa replied to a letter to Pope Eugene IV on the subject, I quote, "We understand that we have been accused of trading Christian slaves to Egypt and other infidel countries. This crime is easy to refute. We have a city named Kaffa on the Crimea. We have a pact with the lords of the neighboring regions," which is interesting because there are several lords of the neighboring regions. We have Christian reigns on the west border of the Black Sea. We have the Golden Horde still in place in the north of the Black Sea, in today's Russia. And we have the rising Ottoman empire on the south of the Black Sea area, and all of them were involved in slave trade. So we have a pact with the lords of the neighboring regions that slaves from there can only be brought outside the Black Sea basin on our ships, so on Genoese ships. Merchants from all lands and nations have to bring their slaves to Kaffa first, where they are inspected. The bishop of Kaffa and other clergymen ask them if anyone wants to become Christian. If they find anyone wishing to become Christian, this person is taken off board and baptized. This way, not only can no Christian be sold to infidel countries, but we also get several new Christians. Your Holiness will understand now how far from the truth those who tried to throw such stains on the Genoese name are, and who lied so shamelessly to the vicar of Jesus Christ. Well, we do not know if this defense convinced anyone, but the affair did not go further at that time. Otherwise, it could have meant substantial problems for Genoa as a political player and for the involved merchants in particular. But it shows that trade, in other words, economic exchange, often led to cross-cultural cooperation the people involved placed higher priority on than on loyalty to their respective political or cultural groups. Anyway, as I already said, most ships were built for trading missions. The crew were used to the constricted room and other limitations on board. The comfort of passengers, obviously, was secondary. No wonder the travelers complained about the conditions on board. Felix Fabry, a traveler from Ulm in southern Germany, made the trip to Jerusalem in 1483. He described the conditions on board in great detail and in remarkably vivid words. Felix Fabry was another one of those pilgrims going to the Holy Land. And he wrote a kind of handbook for other pilgrims. So he wrote, in the ship's interior, every pilgrim has his own separate space. They are arranged in rows without spaces between them. A puddle of water at the foot of the mast down there emits the most awful stench, worse than a latrine with human waste. When the pilgrims go down to prepare for the night, there is a terrible noise from them making the beds and stirring up dust, and there are big arguments between those laying side by side, especially in the beginning of the journey. They accuse each other of appropriating parts of the other's space. Everyone calls their friends to help, and suddenly the most harmonious groups are at odds. In such disputes, I saw pilgrims go at each other with daggers and swords and yell at each other in terrible agitation. When the commotion dies down as if it had never happened, those slow to lay down come down with their lights and their endless talking, becoming a real burden for their fellow travelers. It's like a youth hostel today. I saw how some impatient pilgrims threw chamber pots towards the burning lights in order to put them out, thus starting great quarrel again. Well, then Felix Fabry talks about snoring, non-stop talking, too hard pillows, too small beds, and so on. Yeah, you get the picture. And then he says it gets very hot in the closed space, and it's full of different smells. One is always sweating and therefore especially restless. Sometimes there are hordes of fleas, bugs, snails, and worms. I rose almost every night and went up to the plain air and felt as if I just got out of a filthy jail. Particularly problematic is the necessary emptying of bladder and bowels. Every pilgrim has an earthen pot beside him for his urine and feces. As it is narrow and dark among the crowd, and many of them are walking around, it often happens that the urine pots fall over before morning, causing an unbearable stench. Well, to better understand the context of such testimonies, we have to bear in mind that in the late 15th century, pilgrimages to Jerusalem have become a new business branch for Venetian and for other merchants. They started to put together organized trips to the Holy Land in a way comparable to the modern all-inclusive tourism. It really is, that's not an exaggeration. The main purpose of such pilgrimages should have been of a spiritual nature, because by traveling to Jerusalem, Rome, or Santiago de Compostela, or other similar sites, the traveler gained indulgence for his sins. The more difficult the journey, the more indulgence he got, more or less. Jerusalem and the Holy Sepulchre, as the most distant from Europe, therefore promised great spiritual benefit, and there were several less important sites on the way conveying smaller but not negligible indulgence. In the course of the 15th century, the number of such trips grew steadily. Even the highly symbolic fall of Constantinople under Ottoman reign in 1453 and the consequent final disintegration of the Christian strongholds in the eastern Mediterranean region could not stop the Western European tourism to the Levant and especially to Jerusalem. Those package tours obviously yielded more profit for a ship's owner, the more pilgrims he took on board. At the same time, Italian merchants were already used to transporting people besides other merchandise, or rather to transport people as a merchandise. As I mentioned, both traded in slaves and had done so for centuries. Anyway, it's not surprising that they put limited effort into making the pilgrims comfortable on board. Nevertheless, the business with organized pilgrimages grew and became more and more professional. Arising disputes between ship owners or patrons and the travelers, sometimes ending before the Italian courts, led to the establishment of contracts. These contracts grew more and more detailed over time and listed every individual service the patron promised to deliver. It's a bit like today, where you have to put everything in written because otherwise you can't expect it to be delivered. So the most disputed points were, among others, who is allowed on board? Interesting question. Are only the chartering pilgrims allowed, or are other travelers allowed too? Who has authority on the ship? The charterer, that is the pilgrim group, or the patron or the captain? Could be an important question. Who determines how long a ship stays in the respective ports? While the pilgrims usually wanted to get home as soon as possible, the ship owner sometimes wanted to stay longer in order to load wine or other goods from the ports on the way. Or like in Grünenberg's case, travelers wanted time to visit some inland sites, like he did on Cyprus, while the patron wanted to continue. As I said before, time was short if they wanted to return in the same year. Also, the pilgrims often complained about the quality and quantity of food, the food which the patron was obligated to provide. The contracts grew longer and longer and reached several pages in the end. In addition, a sea journey could grow exponentially more uncomfortable if the weather conditions were bad. This applied to the inexperienced travelers like tourists or pilgrims, as well as to professional seafarers like merchants, but it never stopped travelers of any kind from setting sail. All this shows that, contrary to common belief, people were quite mobile in the Middle Ages. Depending on their profession, aims, and available funds, travelers of all kinds were common in the Mediterranean basin. In spite of the risks traveling represented, from pirates and robberies to simply unfavorable weather conditions, illness, or general hardship, people moved around as they had done since the earliest times we know about. Much research has been done on the questions surrounding this topic, but much more is still left to do. There are lots of sources who wait for examination and who are supposed to yield more information on traveling, but also on exchange between the different cultural groups. In the meantime, while waiting for more research, I leave you to discover a small part of traveling in the Mediterranean in the 15th century through the eyes of one curious German traveler in our little exhibition at the CVAR. Thank you.
Thank you, Annika. Thank you very, very much. I'm sure we have questions, but rather than asking Annika for more information, I suggest we'll go back to CVAR and chat with our speaker and look at the exhibition and enjoy a glass of wine. CVAR is just down the road, 2 minutes walk. Thank you.